This program is brought to you by Thick Soft Sorbent, the gentlest way to start the day.
Melbourne, one of the world's most livable cities, is about to be reborn. Lifestyles will change, work will be different, communication and travel times will be faster. All because of Melbourne's CityLink. CityLink will unite suburbs to the east, west, north and south as they've never been united before. It truly is Melbourne's link to the future.
The CityLink project is massive. It runs 22 kilometres from end to end. It starts in the north near the Essendon Airport, consisting of 7.5 kilometres of widened and improved Tullamarine Freeway. This links onto 4.5 kilometres of new elevated road, which crosses over the Yarra River via the spectacular new Bolte Bridge. On the south side of the Yarra, the new road connects up with the West Gate Freeway in Port Melbourne, which leads to a major new traffic interchange in South Melbourne. Travelling towards the city along the Monash Freeway, 5 kilometres of widened road will connect to two new multi-lane tunnels. These tunnels bypass the city to also connect with the new Sturt Street interchange in South Melbourne. And there's a new extension connecting Exhibition Street in the city to the start of the Monash Freeway via Batman Avenue.
Melbourne's link to the future started in the past. As early as 1929, the city fathers recognised that traffic flow from east to west had to pass through the city. They discussed a proposal to build a bypass road across the southern edge of the city, but nothing happened. 40 years on, the issue was raised again. For the first time, a tunnel under the Yarra River was mentioned as a possibility, but once again nothing happened.
We had the South Eastern Freeways, we had the Tullamarine Freeway, we had the Eastern Freeway, and all of them converged on the city, but they didn't join. And it was always our hope that we'd start to link some of these freeways.
It is without a doubt one of the most important links into our future.
The Victorian Government really initiated it in September 94 when they put out their formal bid to consortium, Chart and Transurban bid. Very lengthy and painful bid process which went for nearly a year and a half.
When it did finally start to happen, there was one essential difference between the CityLink and most other infrastructure projects in Victoria. BOOT, or Build, Own, Operate and Transfer. In a first for this state, a private company, Transurban, was put together by Transfield and Obayashi to develop the entire CityLink project using its own financial resources. Transurban will own and operate the CityLink for up to 34 years, when it will transfer back to public ownership.
This has never been done anywhere in the world before. This is the biggest privately funded road project that's ever been delivered, and the first project that's been delivered with 100% electronic tolling.
While Transurban owns the CityLink, anyone who wishes to use it will have to pay, and that means tolls.
The problem with cash tolling on a project like this in Melbourne was there was no room for toll plazas because, you know, with tunnels and what have you, and in a very congested urban environment, you can't take big swathes of land for toll plazas. So the only option was electronic tolling. So he said to us, well, look, you're the engineers. You tell me you're good operators. That's your problem. You fix it. We're going to have electronic tolling. I know it hasn't been introduced anywhere else in the world before, but the technology is available now. Shows how good you are.
The Premier played a key role in the final stages when the financiers, developers and lawyers couldn't reach a conclusion.
I'm hopeful they'll be resolved, but we needed to shake a few heads.
And in the end, I fundamentally went down to the office where they're all locked in a room and said, sort it out and do so by a certain time or this project won't proceed. And that focused their minds fairly quickly and they got on with the job and signed the contract.
we finally listed in March 1996 after having won the bid.
The contract to design and build the CityLink was let to a joint venture company formed especially for this project, Transfield-Obayashi Joint Venture. Transfield is one of Australia's leading construction and development companies. Obayashi Corporation is one of the 10 biggest construction companies in the world.
Very, very huge project. In Japan, usually the project is split up into some part and the contractor can take one part of the project. But this is a whole project. So from Obayashi's experience, it's one of the biggest one in the world.
The CityLink project officially started on the 29th of May 1996. In recognition of the International Joint Venture Partnership, the ceremony included a traditional Japanese groundbreaking, where a perfectly formed cone of sand is symbolically broken by the most senior man. Premier Jeff Kennett added a little symbolism of his own.
Although the media on the day were very, very upset, very precious, our media, you understand, when I went and addressed the Melbourne Press Club, they gave me at the end of the luncheon this shovel, and it's a quote from William Blake that was written in 1803, and it says, mock on, 'tis all in vain. You throw the sand against the wind, and the wind blows it back again. So at least some of the journalists, sometime after the event, had a sense of humour.
After another Japanese tradition, this time breaking into a barrel of sake, the CityLink project, Australia's biggest infrastructure development since the Snowy Mountain Scheme, was on the move.
Freeways in the CityLink system look nice and big and wide and fast, but what happens when you get off the system? Are you straight into skinny little lanes so that everything slows down and backs up?
Traffic management will be coordinated between CityLink, Vic Roads and local councils to ensure the network achieves the most efficient traffic movement possible. CityLink will improve traffic flows across the city and significantly increase the number of access points from Melbourne's major arterial roads into the central business district.
Why do we have to pay for something now that we used to use for free?
Tolls only apply to new or significantly improved and widened roadways.
If I come into town as a visitor and get a hire car, who pays for the toll then?
This is up to the individual hire companies to decide. Discuss it with them before you hire the vehicle.
What's the cut-off date for getting an e-tag?
You can apply for an e-tag at any time. The most immediate problem facing the joint venture was to assemble a huge team of designers, engineers and administrators to manage its immense subcontracted workforce.
Well, I think this project is a world-scale project. And we obviously know of large projects that are being built around the world, and this is right up there with the biggest of them.
Because of the enormous scale, the project was split into two parts, the Western and Southern links. The Transfield-Obayashi joint venture subcontracted the design and construction contract for the Western Link to Balderston Hornibrook Engineering.
Tullamarine, the biggest issue we had up there was keeping the traffic flowing, not interfering with the current traffic level, so we had to maintain during the day and all the peak times two lanes of traffic each way.
While traffic flow could be kept up on the Tullamarine Freeway, the upfield rail line had to be closed for some months while construction work went on above the track. This, combined with the proximity of the new roadway to high-density public housing, created a lot of local concern. Community consultation started early and became an important part of the construction process.
What we've done is we've established both on the Southern and Western Link Community Relations Officer, so people can ring in, they can talk to that person. We go out on site, we meet with the residents. Probably one of the main initiatives we established was what we call information sessions. And what we did there was we invited the local residents to a predetermined location with the engineers, with all our maps and drawings, and we actually, the engineers sort of talked directly to the residents and explained what they were doing, why they have to do it, if they had to work at night, why that was. At the same time, it enabled the members of the community to express their concerns to the engineers.
As the footings for the start of the elevated road went in beside the Merry Creek, the design had already changed from its original concept. The first plan was to build the elevated road with precast beams lifted into place by cranes. Because of limited space and unstable ground conditions, the builders opted instead for a technique called matched cast segmental. Put simply, it's a series of identical cast concrete road segments assembled like rows of giant building blocks. The technique is often used overseas, but this is a first for Australia.
So we had to adopt the designs from overseas, build the launching trusses, the systems here in Australia, and get people operating them and experienced with them here. So that was a huge task in getting all that learning, then producing it for the first time, commissioning and making it happen.
A special concrete casting plant was built at Laverton to make the units. It's the biggest purpose-built precast yard in the Southern Hemisphere. Over the 18 months it took to build the elevated road, 3,500 precast units were built, each weighing up to 80 tonnes.
The concrete's delivered on a truck, lifted in there with what we call a straddle carrier, then onto a segment loader. The segment loader places it onto a truss. On the truss, it is pulled out into the right position. The next segment comes along, and so the segments are delivered and placed on the truss. When you have a full span completed, the 13 units are pulled real tight, and that forms the first span and is placed on the bearings. There's post-tensioning, so stressing strand is run through there. Then the trusses launch themselves forward, and then we commence another span. We had 210 of those to go through on the main line itself, and then there was about 92 on the ramps, because there's 3.5 kilometres of ramps on the project as well.
At the southern end of the elevated road, work started on a spectacular new bridge over the Yarra River.
The first challenge for Yarra Bridge was building the central island. That's the main support for the bridge, it's the centre pier. Now we had to build an island out there. We used 200,000 tonnes of gravel, so we constructed an island, and then we went and excavated a hole, put some shoring in there and drove piles. Our piles went down to about 55 metres.
Once the piles were driven, a massive concrete cap was poured to provide the base for the bridge piers. 3,000 cubic metres, that's 600 truckloads of concrete, were pumped in a continuous pour that lasted 24 hours.
Main feature of the project, I suppose, are the two tunnels. Certainly on Southern Link, they are the jewel in the crown, so to speak.
The Southern Link consists of roadworks to widen 5 kilometres of the Monash Freeway and the construction of two tunnels under the Yarra River. The westbound tunnel starts near Punt Road and takes traffic from the Monash Freeway under the Yarra River and King's Domain to Sturt Street, South Melbourne. The eastbound tunnel starts at Sturt Street and will take traffic 3.4 kilometres under the Yarra River, the Glass House and South Richmond to exit at Burnley. Excavation for both tunnels started simultaneously at Burnley, South Melbourne and Swan Street, Richmond. This site was the midpoint of the longer Burnley Tunnel and the starting point for some major geological challenges for the project.
Along the Yarra River Basin, hundreds of millions of years of silt deposits have buried the underlying bedrock up to 30 metres deep. The material between the rock and the sky is a mushy mix of silts, gravels and groundwater seeping through from the Yarra. To dig the midway shaft at the Swan Street side, the engineers came up with an innovative solution, ground freezing. A series of holes were bored around the perimeter of the shaft and a refrigerant solution pumped through pipes sunk in the ground. The water in the soil froze and became solid enough to be excavated from the shaft.
The major influence on the tunnels generally has been the geology and the geology of Melbourne, and I suppose this project has really encapsulated Melbourne's geological history over the last 400 million years.
Unlike Swan Street, the excavation at the Burnley portal was through solid basalt rock. After some initial blasting, the engineers brought in the big guns, the first of five special excavators called roadheaders. We caught a brief glimpse before they went underground for 18 months of solid digging.
Each roadheader weighs 105 tonnes and is electrically powered. The rotating pineapple head has 60 tungsten-tipped teeth grinding away at the rock face. Across the whole of the project, these monsters did the bulk of the tunnelling. When the excavation moved underground at Burnley, a special noise-reducing roof was installed, along with a dust extraction and filtration plant. While this most up-to-date piece of equipment seemed to be irresistible, history forced a small change in tunnel direction. An old quarry site had to be bypassed because it may have been contaminated by waste from the leather tanneries that once were the main industry here.
We've had to look very hard at the alignment of the tunnels to make sure they're in the rock or in the best possible geological place for the tunnels.
The tunnelling was done in two stages, with the roadheaders carving out the arch top half, followed some weeks or even months later by excavators taking out the lower half of the tunnel.
We would cut the top half of the tunnel, the top heading, at a 6 metre height. We would then have to install immediately some form of ground support. So we might put up these major steel arches. We might use pre-tensioned rock bolts, shotcreting, a variety of different techniques. Following that, we would then effectively move up our services, our ventilation, our air, water, etc., etc., and then start the excavation process again. So it's just a 24-hour repetitive cycle.
I live in Williamstown, but I work in Camberwell. How can I avoid paying the tolls?
There's no charge for using the West Gate Freeway to Southbank. Your present route to Camberwell via City Road and Swan Street will still be available and toll-free.
Well, can I put my ETAG account on my FPOS account so it comes out straight away?
Yes. Prepay accounts can be topped up automatically through a credit card standing authorisation or bank account direct debit.
What happens if you drive on the roads without an ETAG?
If the vehicle you're driving is linked to an ETAG account but you've forgotten your ETAG, your account will be billed the normal toll plus a $1 administration charge. If you do not have a valid ETAG account or day pass when you use CityLink, you will need to contact the CityLink customer centre before 12 noon the day after you use the road to purchase a late day pass. If you don't make arrangements to pay for CityLink tolls, you may be sent an infringement notice by the Government Enforcement Agency. Close to the Yarra River, the first obvious change for commuters was the temporary removal of some of the famous elm trees of Batman and Alexandra Avenues. Preparations for the operation took almost 12 months, and the effort to move these special trees cost more than $1 million.
37 trees have been moved successfully on the project, and we haven't had one die to date.
The tree removal operation was to prepare for the remodelling of Batman Avenue. The area was the site for the entry portal of the westbound domain tunnel under the Yarra River to South Melbourne.
Over in South Melbourne, work started on the two tunnels. The initial excavation site was under Grant Street, just next to the Victorian College of the Arts. The plan was to return the site to public use near the end of the project. But because access to the college would be severely disrupted, the VCA asked for an early return of Grant Street. That change in timetable sent the designers back to the drawing board.
We actually were intending originally to drive tunnels under St Kilda Road, but with a revised configuration, we actually did it by what we call a top-down construction method.
Instead of tunnelling, Transfield-Obayashi engineers adopted the cut-and-cover method of excavation. In this process, rows of deep piles are bored through the topsoil into the underlying rock. Concrete roof beams are cast over the tops of the piles, and then the staged excavation removes the fill. The concrete piles now become the walls. Another layer of beams is installed with a slab floor poured on top. Below this floor, the staged excavation continues down to road level when concrete road paving is poured.
Up on St Kilda Road itself, we've had to, for a period of 3 months, divert traffic backwards and forwards from the service lanes to the centre. With the trams, we had to, every night for 6 weeks, pull down the overhead lines every night, dig a hole, put the overhead lines back up and get the trams up and running the next morning.
Once the cut and cover team reached St Kilda Road, it handed over to the miners, who drove two tunnels towards the Yarra River. The cut and cover team turned around and started working back towards Sturt Street, while two road headers started operations driving the slightly diverging tunnels.
We excavated close on a quarter of a million cubic metres of dirt out of this area. While we've carried that out, we've had to maintain access for driven tunnels, and in some occasions they were placing up to 1,000 cubic metres of concrete per day, which is the equivalent of 400 truck movements just through our site to maintain their works.
We had 6 tunnels concurrently being constructed, and we had 45 work fronts working in parallel, right back to the New Jersey barriers that were being installed at the back end of the tunnel with the face still being excavated.
At what used to be the Olympic Park Greyhound track, work starts on the entrance to the westbound Domain Tunnel. Because it starts so close to the river, the tunnel won't be steep enough to go under the Yarra so much as through it, at least the bottom of it. For Melburnians, it's a chance to find out what really is at the bottom of our river.
The design for the Yarra River crossing took 15 to 18 months of value engineering to finally come up not with one solution, but several.
There are 6 major structural elements in what we're doing here. Down in the Punt Road area, we have a buoyancy structure which run from the portal towards Punt Road.
Gary Griffion is site engineer at Olympic Park. His work area extends just 800 metres. But with the Yarra River only metres away, and Punt Road and Batman Avenue running through his patch of ground, Gary reckons it's the toughest section of the whole CityLink.
One of the immediate issues that we have on this site is, of course, the proximity of the Yarra and the water and the potential of draining Port Phillip Bay if you don't do it right. So I guess you have that incentive to keep your feet dry.
The first 300 metres of tunnel was constructed from pre-cast curved concrete sections. These were lowered into the excavation that headed towards and under Batman Avenue. Once the two halves were located and sealed for waterproofing, the excavation was backfilled. In one 35-metre section of the culvert, high water levels in the porous ground threatened to float the tunnel. The solution was to drill 112 cable bolts down through 20 metres of silt rock and mud to embed them into the underlying solid rock. 39 kilometres of steel cable tied down this 35-metre section of roadway.
The geology is so variable in the space of 100 metres. It goes from rock to essentially slush, and you're dealing with constructing things directly under the river. It presents a lot of challenges to be able to build structures in those sorts of conditions.
On the eastern side of the Yarra crossing, the team used a top-down construction method based on the cut-and-cover technique. In a multi-stage process, a bund or rock platform was built into the river. When the bund was completed, a cofferdam of pile-driven steel sheets was built around it. Once it was sealed and relatively watertight, a perimeter row of holes was drilled down to bedrock and then part filled with reinforced concrete. Later, these columns were uncovered and formed the side walls of the tunnel. The fill above the tops of the columns was removed and a huge concrete lid poured. The concrete is 2 metres thick with kilometres of reinforcing steel and is now at the top of the tunnel or the bottom of the Yarra, depending on where you stand.
We had to actually divert the river backwards and forwards and narrow it for a period of 3 years. We had to negotiate with the boat users, the dragon boat rowers and various other groups to get a system of priority on the river, and we established that over time, and that again has worked pretty well.
How are they going to know I've used the CityLink if I don't have an e-tag?
The tolling equipment will take a digital image of your licence plate number. The system will then check to see if you have purchased a day pass or if your vehicle is linked to an account but not carrying the e-tag.
I'm just concerned if there's some sort of a blockage or a backup on the link. Are there ways of getting the cars off the system?
CityLink incorporates state-of-the-art traffic management and emergency response systems to minimise any blockages. Electronic message signs will inform motorists of traffic conditions and advise drivers on how to proceed.
Well, I don't reckon I'll use CityLink enough to warrant a toll account. How do I apply for a day permit?
Anyone who uses CityLink more than about 6 times a year will be better off opening an account and obtaining an e-tag. Day passes allow unlimited travel on CityLink on a nominated day. On the Western Link, the elevated road was progressing rapidly after an early setback when one of the precast units was dropped onto a ramp. Fortunately, the only injury was the pride of the crew.
At that stage, we'd done less than 15% of the whole structure, and the really good thing about that was the concentration of effort that it put by people, so that in the next 12 months following that, the remainder of the structure was built and finished.
The elevated road's not just a straight line, there are many curves, on and off ramps were difficult. When these launching trusses go forward, they go forward, sideways, and what we call kinematics are drawn up for every single span. So you've got 300 sets of these kinematics. So engineers spend a lot of time detailing exactly how they go around a curve.
Early in 1997, road widening work started along the Tullamarine Freeway. This will increase the traffic flow from 2 to 4 lanes in each direction.
Designing something that could be built without disrupting traffic to the extent that's absolutely necessary, that's a key objective. We've got 100,000 vehicles on Tullamarine Freeway every day, and somehow we've got to build the whole thing in the midst of all of this.
Transfield-Obayashi developed a traffic management team to plan and implement a range of lane and road closures. On the Monash Freeway alone, there have been almost 700 lane closures for various periods.
Here on the South Eastern, we've had a series of barriers. The existing barriers were about 17 kilometres when you include the ones in the centre and on each side. We've had to supplement that with a further 10 kilometres of concrete barriers, which we've moved 30 or 45 times. So all in all, it keeps the guys very busy.
The Swan Street shaft at the midpoint of the Burnley Tunnel eventually reached a maximum depth of 65 metres, and a mini road header was lowered in to widen the area. Once there was enough room, 2 full-sized road headers and dump trucks were lowered into the shaft to excavate in opposite directions. But water seepage was to be an ongoing problem.
Water has been one of the issues during construction. We've had extensive surveys of all of the areas of land surrounding the tunnel construction. We've had monitoring processes in place. The things that are happening on this project are really no different to tunnelling anywhere else in the world. There's just an issue there we've got to deal with, and it hasn't been easy. I think we've dealt with it.
Safety is a constant concern in any construction project, particularly one that brings together so many different techniques and technologies.
To minimise the risk of personal injury, every worker, subcontractor and visitor to any site was given a safety induction program and supplied with personal protective equipment.
15,000 approximately set of gumboots, possibly 30 to 35,000 normal steel cap boots, reflective vests, because we're working both with the public and public transport areas, we've had to use both red and yellow reflective vests, and again we're looking at roughly 25 to 30,000 there. Hard hats, your normal construction hard hats, 30, 35,000. A number of them equipped with the ear protection built in. We would estimate 2,000 of those. Eye protection, either the glasses or the full goggles, we would estimate about 30,000 of those. And disposable earplugs, we'd be looking at more than a quarter million.
For both Southern and Western Links, every employee and subcontractor had to go through at least two safety inductions. The first was an in-depth instruction session on the health and safety policy and expectations of the project. Workers then had to have a second, third, or even fourth site induction. Throughout the project, Transfield-Obayashi ran more than 13,000 general inductions and at least twice that number of site-specific inductions. Although Transfield-Obayashi went to great lengths to avoid all injuries, in 1997, Justin O'Connor, a subcontractor's employee, died after slipping into an excavation.
Along the Monash Freeway, road widening has started. Between Toorak Road and Burnley, the traffic carrying capacity will increase from 2 to 3 lanes in each direction.
Supporting piers are built next to the existing elevated roadway between Glenferry Road and the Yarra River. Almost 3 kilometres of existing elevated road has to be widened. This is another first for the project, the longest widening of any elevated road in Australia.
It involves building new foundation piers and piles to support the new structure, concrete beams generally that have to be stitched in to the existing structure. It was a matter of trying to sort of isolate the traffic onto one side of the works as best you can while you get in and give yourself enough space to build the new section of bridge and stitch it in to the old elevated bridge or roadway.
Nearer the city, the freeway was widened by driving a line of piles into the Yarra River. Over the following months, a deck was formed and concrete poured to create the extra lane of roadway. Other parts of the freeway were widened by excavating back into the road reserve. Where it created a sheer wall, the retaining wall was rock bolted back into the ground. At Burnley, this created a small problem for the MacRobertson Bridge. Over the Christmas period in 1997-98, the bridge was closed while an extra lane was created beneath it and the bridge lengthened to span the lane. Just a few weeks later,
I now declare the MacRobertson Bridge officially reopened.
Can I get a day pass just to use one small part of the link, like from the city to Burnley, say, on the Exhibition Street extension?
All day passes give you unlimited access to CityLink for a nominated day and cost $7, or $8 for a late day pass.
How will I know when to put money into my account when I have low credit?
When your account balance falls below $25, your e-tag will emit a double beep as you pass under a toll gantry, indicating you should make arrangements to top up your account. When your account balance drops below $10, you will be sent a letter reminding you the account needs to be topped up.
What happens if my e-tag's stolen? Can someone else use it?
You should report the theft to CityLink. Your e-tag will be cancelled immediately, and a new e-tag will be issued without charge on presentation of a police report.
E-tag tolls tax deductible?
You will have to ask your accountant or the tax office how the current ruling affects you or your business.
Early in 1998, and history is made as miners from Swan Street and Grand Street break through in the Burnley Tunnel. The site of the breakthrough is somewhere under the glasshouse.
Are you ready to proceed over there?
The Premier and a swarm of media are on hand to witness the moment from one side, while the crew from South Melbourne wait impatiently on the other.
All right, well, please keep Victoria on the move.
Eventually, a crack of light on one side is matched by cracking rock on the other. And within a few minutes, miners, media crews, and a good crowd of supporters mingle on both sides of the breakthrough. By the time the excavation is completed, 500,000 cubic metres of compacted soil will have been taken out of the Burnley Tunnel.
A month later, the second breakthrough occurs when the Burnley Tunnel crew cuts through in a cloud of dust somewhere under East Richmond.
This is a very private breakthrough. No reporters and politicians. It's a special moment for all the project employees. On the Swan Street side, people from all the site offices and job sites gather.
This represents a fairly major milestone for the joint venture.
On the other side, the Burnley Street workers wait for the moment. There's a little more excitement this time as the miners step through the opening for the first time. Soon everyone gets a chance to see the other side, and those who had them were glad they'd brought their gumboots. This completes the heading of the Burnley Tunnel. Following close behind is the benching out operation, where the bottom of the tunnel is excavated, creating the final height of 9 metres. At the Yarra crossing, the Batman Avenue side of the tunnel is completed. The cofferdam is carefully flooded and the sheet piling removed. Within days, the cut and cover team relocates to the Alexandra Avenue bank to begin the process all over again. On that side, though, the underlying bedrock is closer to the surface, with a thinner layer of silt rock. This caused the construction method to change from top down to bottom up. A cofferdam was built with sheet piles driven into the bedrock and held in place by large diameter steel props. All the loose silted rock is excavated to a depth of 20 metres, making this one of the deepest cofferdams ever constructed in Australia.
This job's been fairly difficult, probably one of the most difficult that I've been involved in, for the reasons that it's been a really deep excavation.
Once the bedrock was exposed, the floor slab was poured, followed by the walls and finally the roof. In just 200 metres of cut and cover tunnel under the Yarra, more than 1,000 tonnes of steel was used to reinforce 10,000 cubic metres of concrete.
Well, currently we're backfilling the cofferdam, and then once we've completed that, we'll reinstate the bank and replace the 14 elm trees on the bank here, and then we'll see what job comes up next.
We're presently standing some 14 metres below the water surface under the river, under the Yarra River. On this slab is some 2 metres thick, and surrounding us in this area, we've got Coot Island silts and muds. The traffic will move from the portal structure down this direction, the 3 lanes moving towards the west into the driven tunnels area, which starts under Alexandra Avenue and the botanical gardens. The traffic turns around this curve and will slowly head up towards Grant Street.
On the Western Link, a delicate balancing act has started at the site of the Bolte Bridge.
The bridge itself is a balanced cantilever concrete bridge. So it basically starts at the centre and we pour units 4.3 metres wide out each way until we actually create half a span. And then from the other piers we join. And so then the bridge is joined in the centre once the balanced cantilevers reach in a 2.5 metre pour. People often wondered whether that we would actually join in the bridge at the centre, and we did. You know, there's a slight misalignment of about 30 millimetres, but that is balanced up in the closure pour.
In the Burnley Tunnel, concrete lining began. The tunnel was firstly sheathed and sealed with heavy plastic sheeting. The arch former was positioned and a seal created at the outer edge. Concrete was then pumped into the space between the arch former and the tunnel wall. It took 24 hours to set up, fill and cure each 12.5 metre section of tunnel. Later, the joints were grouted to ensure the tunnels are totally watertight. In the Burnley Tunnel, 116,000 cubic metres of concrete were pumped in to line the arch and form the pavement.
Yeah, well, if I get an ETAG for one car, can I transfer that to other cars in the family?
A standard account allows up to 4 vehicles to use the one ETAG. All vehicles must be registered with the account. If the vehicles are going to be using CityLink frequently, it will be more convenient and no more costly to obtain an ETAG for each vehicle.
After buying the initial ETAG, is it going to cost me $25 each year, regardless of how many times I use it?
To maintain the ETAG account, you must spend at least $25 on tolls per year. If you spend only $24 on tolls, you'll be billed the extra dollar to make up the $25 minimum annual toll payment.
Can I lend my ETAG to a friend?
Yes, providing your friend's vehicle is linked to your ETAG account.
How do interstaters get charged for toll and how will they be educated?
Special arrangements have been put in place for taxis and hire cars, which will cover many interstate visitors. Those visitors arriving by road will need to purchase a day pass. Signage at the airport and on the approaches to CityLink will let visitors know about CityLink and arrangements required to use the expressway. Construction of the vent stack started at the ends of the Burnley and Domain tunnels. The Burnley vent stack was built to suit the local neighbourhood. The South Melbourne vent stack was designed to fit in with future development at the Arts Precinct. The design of the tunnels takes into account several aspects for handling exhaust emissions.
The air travels with the motor vehicles from the entrance portal right through to the exit portal. The vehicles themselves will actually assist the air to move through the tunnels because they develop something that's called a piston effect, where the air is driven by the vehicles through the tunnel itself. And the ventilation fans that we install in the tunnel are installed effectively to control that movement of air. If you've got a large number of vehicles travelling through the tunnel at any one time, you would end up with a fairly high piston effect, in which case we may have to run some of the jet fans that are installed in the ceiling of the tunnel in reverse to actually slow the air down. The large fans that are located at the vent stacks at either end of the tunnel are there to draw the air out of the tunnel once it gets to the portal area. They're effectively like the exhaust point and they are just used to draw the air straight out at that point.
When the joint venture applied to the Environment Protection Authority for a works permit to install the tunnel ventilation system, it became a contentious issue for local residents. Transfield-Obayashi had to defend the design, height and siting of the vents for more than a year of argument to the EPA and appeal bodies.
Specifically, the issues for the community were about fine particles. They are very small particles emitted from vehicle emissions. those issues were dealt with, we demonstrated that we could comply with the environmental standards set for the project and now which are national standards set for Australia.
One of the requirements on this project is to not allow any of the polluted air that is travelling through the tunnel to come out of the exhaust portal. So the vent stacks are there to effectively draw all of the polluted air from the tunnel out through the ventilation stacks and disperse it into the atmosphere at that point.
So there will be very little impact on the community, and generally for Melbourne there is a significant benefit in terms of traffic management, and potentially we should see a drop in ambient air quality pollution levels.
To further reduce the impact of the vent stacks on local residents, considerable work went into noise reduction around the giant extraction fans.
We're currently located at the sound attenuation panels, which form part of the ventilation system on the mezzanine floor of the Grand Street structure. These panels dampen the sound either side of the main fans, which is, you can see behind me, and these panels cut out markedly the sound emitted from the fans. Now you'll see I'm about to go and turn my microphone off. I'm going to do that now and I'll keep on talking after that.
The microphone's now off and you should notice a significant decrease in the amount of sound. Just showing how effective those panels actually are. Turning it back on.
You can now see the effectiveness of those panels is certainly marked.
On the Tullamarine Freeway, the issue of noise was also being addressed. New lightweight concrete sound walls were installed. On the elevated road, an open span noise deflection tube was installed to reduce the impact of the road on nearby residents. In another first, the road would eventually be surfaced with a new type of noise reducing asphalt. To mark the start of the elevated road and provide an impressive sculptural welcome to Melbourne, the gateway was erected. The gateway consists of a yellow sculptured wall balanced by two rows of red sticks that unzip to create a changing perspective as we drive toward the city. To install the final dominant part of the sculpture, the yellow blade, the Tullamarine Freeway was closed on three consecutive Saturday nights. The completed blade is a massive structure 5 metres square, 70 metres in length, and weighs in at 280 tonnes. And despite the various rumours, the structure is sound.
Not cracking, not sinking, not falling over. It's a monument to Melbourne.
After midnight, one Saturday in August 1998, the first tolling gantry was installed near Albion Street on the Tullamarine Freeway.
Melbourne CityLink has been designed and built for a non-stop road tolling system. 9 toll points spread along the entire CityLink will electronically detect and charge motorists who use part or all of the new or improved road network. In putting the tolling system together, there were a number of world firsts created right here.
It utilises technology that's never been used in this form before. So from a point of view of technology, we're very much a world leader. That of course has its inconveniences as well, because we've been unable to go to the Bible and check anything. So we're setting new benchmarks, and from a technology point of view, that's something that Australians can feel very, very proud of.
Some countries do use electronic tolling, but the drivers have to crowd into one lane and travel through the toll point at just 40 kilometres an hour.
It's a system that can track across multiple lanes of a freeway and allow free flow of traffic, which is that traffic can change from lane to lane and can change its speed in that lane change, and the tolling system will still record it. The system works from what is known as an e-tag. This tag has the ability of what is known as read and write, and simply put, that means that it sends a signal
out to the gantry and receives the signal from the gantry. And all that most people would normally hear from that is a single beep as you pass under the gantry to say that a tag transaction has taken place.
The electronic conversation between the e-tag and the central computer takes about 80 milliseconds. In that brief moment, a lot of processing goes on.
A short range radio signal that sends that signal down, records the passage of the tag under the gantry, takes that signal back, checks at the same time that there is a valid account by registering the license plate number of the car against a predetermined account which is locked into that license plate number. If, as I said previously, you have a valid account, you have an account that has money in it, more importantly, then all you would hear would be the single beep. If you haven't got a valid account, then what happens is at the same time that the license plate number is recorded, a video image is also recorded of the license plate in the car, and that is later passed on for enforcement if you haven't got that valid account in place.
Do you get a discount if you use the tolls regularly?
No.
Are the rates higher during peak hour or is it cheaper during peak hour periods?
There are no peak or off-peak rates for cars. To encourage commercial vehicles to use CityLink during lighter traffic periods, a reduced rate will apply between 8pm and 6am.
Will people be charged extra for towing caravans and trailers?
No, trailers and caravans towed behind cars will not cost extra.
Will we be forced to use the CityLink if we're travelling on connecting arterials, and will there be signs to say that we are now entering into the toll zone?
Prominent advanced signage located 5, 2 and 1 kilometres before the start of CityLink on the major approaches will advise motorists they're approaching a toll road. Signs at all entry and exit points from the expressway will also clearly indicate tolls apply on CityLink. As the CityLink nears completion, overnight road closures become more common as the last parts are put into place. On the Monash Freeway, Super T beams go in overnight at Glenferry Road. Punt Road is closed over several nights as huge steel beams are jockeyed into position to widen the Moor's Head Bridge. And over a weekend, another series of steel girders are lowered into position to span the Yarra River near Scotch College. At the end of January this year, the Monash Freeway was closed overnight as new low-profile steel beams went under the Church Street Bridge. This was part of the preparation for the two biggest road closures of the entire project. On two weekends in February, the Monash Freeway was closed for works to the Cremorne Railway Bridge and Church Street Bridge.
They started at 12 o'clock on a Friday night and went right through to Sunday morning. To do that, we actually had to relocate or move about 120,000 passengers on the rail going over the rail bridge over to one side of the rail bridge, and also relocate 100,000 vehicles into the traffic network.
The works on the Cremorne and Church Street bridges increased the height clearance under the old bridges. As with every other part of the project, it wasn't straightforward. Several options were examined and assessed. One suggestion was to lower the roadway, but this would have put the road at risk from regular flooding. Another suggestion was to raise the road and rail bridges. This was also impractical and expensive. It was finally decided to replace the existing bridge supporting beams with new high-strength, low-profile beams. In continuous operations, the old concrete arches at the Church Street Bridge were cut through and slowly removed. The bridge was now fully supported by the new low-profile steel arches. At the Cremorne Railway Bridge, old sections were cut out and removed. These were replaced by new sections. More than 10 million man-hours have gone into the construction of the Transurban CityLink. As the deadline for opening drew near, inevitably there were delays. Delays with testing the tolling system, and further delays with the manufacture and distribution of the e-tags.
When we started our marketing campaign, we were frankly delighted that we had a rush on our e-tags, our call centre had an enormous number of problems, and that's manifested in a number of customer interface problems. We moved some time ago to actually take direct control of our operator and direct management control of our call centre to massively improve this customer interface.
And as if that wasn't enough, the Bolte Bridge hit the headlines again, with claims that bits of concrete were breaking off.
The bridge has got a few small problems in terms of stressing, or at least the concrete cracking as a result of the stressing. It's not a safety issue for the bridge, it's really a long-term maintenance issue for the bridge, and there's some repairs going on to that. While we're doing the work, we've currently got loadings on the bridge which are probably far in excess of the loadings that will be on the bridge when the traffic flows.
It is the toughest thing I've ever done, and I've learnt that anything is possible, and we never gave up, and that's why we've got the Western Link today.
The Southern Link will open in about 2 to 3 months' time. The final safety systems are currently being installed. Once completed, the Domain and Burnley Tunnels will have the most sophisticated traffic management and safety systems in the world.
Thousands of kilometres of electric and fibre optic cables have been installed throughout the CityLink. These cables all lead to the control room of the operations and maintenance building, the brain at the centre of this incredibly complex road system. Two separate computers control the traffic and tolling systems. In the central control room, operators manage the entire system through the most advanced traffic management computer system in Australia and one of the most sophisticated in the world. Closed-circuit TV, automatic incident detection, variable message signs and radio rebroadcast are just a few of the special facilities available to these operators.
One of the safety features designed to keep traffic flowing and the public safe is the closed circuit TV system. The instant you press the button on the emergency phone, it rings in the control room and activates an icon on the computer. The nearest closed circuit camera then swings towards you so the operator can see you and hear you. The operator will then call police, fire, ambulance or towing.
CityLink control room, Ian speaking.
Yes, hello Ian, I'm stopped in the sound tube and the car won't start.
Okay, we'll arrange for our incident response team to come out to you. If you'd just like to move back to your car and they'll be there shortly.
Melbourne now boasts one of the world's most interactive traffic systems, with electronic message boards warning of lane or road blockages, giving motorists time to get off the link or change lanes early to keep traffic moving.
And the operator also can pre-select a radio rebroadcast, which will automatically then go to the radio in your car, whether you're on an AM station or an FM station. The tunnel incident management signs will tell the motorists to switch on their radio if they're listening to their CDs, and any station, AM or FM, will then pick up the operator's message.
And we can use mobile phones in the tunnels. All three mobile phone companies have installed relays in the tunnels.
There is a series of fire detection systems in the tunnel which can include a fibre optic cable that runs the full length of the tunnel, and this cable is sensitive to heat in the tunnel, so if there is a fire it generates an alarm and the operators can respond to that alarm.
If there is an emergency situation and the people have to evacuate the Burnley Tunnel, they can use one of these cross passages that lead from the Burnley Tunnel through to the Domain Tunnel. If the motorists are advised by the emergency services, they can be brought into this area at the bottom of a set of stairs where they can be then directed by the emergency services personnel to walk through these stairs following the exit signs to the Domain Tunnel, which is at the top of this stairway.
Do I get a discount for say, a $50 e-tag compared to a day pass?
For regular users, an e-tag is much more economical than buying day passes.
I've heard you can get demerit points if you use the CityLink without paying for the toll. Is that true?
No.
Are there any speed cameras hidden on the link?
No, the CityLink tolling and traffic management systems are not designed to enforce speed limits.
Does everyone have to buy an e-tag?
No, but if you use CityLink more than six times a year, it will generally be more economical to set up an account and obtain an e-tag than to use day passes.
Was it true that Transurban will up the toll every 3 months or so?
Under Transurban's agreement with the state government, tolls can be increased quarterly. Tolls cannot increase by more than the consumer price index, or 4.5% per year, whichever is the greater. End of the CityLink project is in sight. Restoration started last year with the return of the elm trees to Batman Avenue. Although only a small crowd braved a wintry night to witness this piece of history. Tens of thousands of new trees, shrubs and grasses are now being planted right across the CityLink. When it's completed, we're assured Melbourne will be cleaner and greener than it's been for some years. So, how will CityLink affect you? If you choose to use it, travel times will be reduced because of the new expressways. We're told that travelling will be safer because there's less danger from intersection and traffic light smashes. And the environment will benefit from reduced exhaust emissions as stop-start motoring becomes a thing of the past.
People going through it or into it are going to have far greater, quicker access. So I think it's going to be very good for Melbourne.
Oh, I think it's fantastic. I think that it's appalling that you should have to be paying for road usage, considering that our parents' and grandparents' taxes have been paying for roads for a long time, and so has the petrol tax.
An exciting project, a very big project, but I'm devastated that it will be a tollway.
I think it'll be an improvement.
It will make the traffic flow more quickly, but as seen in Europe, the tendency is that you'll have to build another link, another surrounding ring road, and it'll continue, and it's a vicious cycle.
Well, the CityLink will be good. We see it every morning here, the traffic build up across the road. People may complain now, but once it's opened, I think they'll find it's the best thing to happen to Melbourne.
This is a fantastic project for Melbourne. It will really improve the way Melburnians can get around the city. There'll be huge savings in time, there'll be savings in petrol, there'll be saving in running costs, and also the environment should be improved because we'll have no cars stopped or just idling along the freeways as they do at the moment. So for Melbourne, this is a brilliant piece of infrastructure, and it's fantastic that it's finally is here.
So how much will it cost you? Until the Southern Link is completed in a few months, special introductory rates will apply for the Western Link. If you travel along the Tullamarine Freeway from Moreland Road to the city, you'll pay 49 cents. If you take the new elevated road, you'll be in Zone 2 and have to add on another 97 cents. If you continue over the Bolte Bridge and onto the West Gate Freeway, you'll pass through Tollgate 3 and add $1.22 to the cost of the journey. The total cost for the one-way trip from Buller Road to Sturt Street, South Melbourne, will be $2.68. According to computer projections, the saving in travel time could be as much as 20 minutes.
The fact is, it is here. We have to accept the fact there are tolls on it. But there have been a number of suggestions put to us by members that could enhance their desire to use the toll road. We have put those to Transurban. Many of them have been adopted. And we're hopeful that in the future many more will be adopted, particularly to make it easier for and cheaper for country people to come and use the link.
We've still got a lot to learn. We've learned a lot. And we will be trying to optimise the use, because our returns are directly related with maximising the use of the link, and we want as much use of the link as we can possibly get.
Of course, you don't have to use CityLink. The existing alternate routes will stay open. If you want to reduce or avoid paying tolls, work out a strategy to balance convenience against cost. Commuters hurrying to get to work on time may consider paying the toll worthwhile in the morning, but take a slower, no-cost way home at night when there's not such a need to beat the clock. Because at this stage there aren't any off-peak tolls,
it makes sense to look at alternate routes at night and on weekends. Late night travel times on the alternate routes may not be that much slower than on the CityLink.
The big advantage for the average motorist is that CityLink will be extremely popular with transport companies.
Well, we as an industry hope that no one else uses CityLink and it's left to the trucking industry. That will suit us 100% because it is going to have such a huge effect on the freight business that we will become very much more efficient. We're going to be more certain with our times of delivery, and it's certainly going to cut the costs of transport.
There's no doubt CityLink will be a great boon for Melbourne's drivers. So let's buckle up, put on our e-tag and go for a preview drive through the Transurban CityLink, proudly designed and constructed by Transfield-Obayashi Joint Venture and built by thousands of engineers, technicians and tradespeople who came to Melbourne to build a link to the future.
I think it is one of our greatest, or probably our greatest achievement ever, and we're extremely proud of it.
From a world engineering perspective, I think this project has been world class.
Yeah, we're pretty proud of it, and Australia should be proud of it as well.
Sort of like a once in a lifetime opportunity, and to be able to do that in your hometown and get to go home every night, it's spot on.
It's just bigger than everything else, you know. You know, all jobs have their hard times and their easy times, but this one, like, sort of has big hard times.
Nightline is next on 9, then Espionage Adventure with Peter Wilson. She's La Femme Nikita. Catherine McClements is Goldie, facing every mother's nightmare on a hard-hitting episode of Water Rats, the very best in Australian crime drama, 8:30 tomorrow night, followed by Stingers,